Perfect.
I was here last year. So last year I was sharing my experiences, what did I learn while implementing Scrum in two organizations. That's where my experience is. I helped to transform one organization to Scrum in Sweden while I was working there. And then came back to Lithuania, joined Adform, and from 2010, early spring, we are working fully according to Scrum. So last year I was sharing experiences about issues and problems we had and how we solved them. So I guess it was not so boring that I got invitation to come here again. So thanks for that. Hopefully I'll be not so boring today again. And today I'll talk about product management, because as you will see, we have a big product that we're developing and 8 teams are working on it. So we have that challenge, how to make sure that when 60 developers are putting code to the code database and we release every 2 weeks, that everything still works as one coherent system. So yeah, of course you can find my presentation on SlideShare already, so those who are online or don't see it very well, you can download or later use it. Shortly about me, as I mentioned, I'm working at Adform currently, and I am working as product manager. I started actually as system analyst, then was Scrum Master, and now I'm officially product manager, because you know, HR has to write a name in your contract that has some meaning for them. But of course, I'm working as product owner with the teams. So that's my role. On the other side, out of work, I'm trying to initiate this Agile Lithuania community, and I'm very happy that it is active. We already organized 3 conferences and have every month a user group meeting. So really more and more people joining and sharing these experiences. And I bet you have heard Lithuanian language around. I think there is actually quite a bunch of Lithuanians here. So great to see the collaboration. The same as guys from Agile Latvia, we came to Agile Tour this October and gave a talk. So nice to see that we can share what we learn. What the topic is about, as I said, when you read books, it's always about this perfect Scrum framework where you have Scrum team, Scrum master, product owner, and you know, this very simple and everything is very easy. But my question is how to deal with that when you have 8 teams like that. How to divide it, the product, how to plan, how to execute, and how to make sure that everything still works. So I'll start a bit with context to get you in the system, because we'll talk about components, so you know what it is. Then we talk how we organize teams and why, and then where product owners, managers came from, and how we build the product management organization, which was not in our company 2 years ago. Then how to plan the features, how you can plan a feature which has to be executed by 4 or 5 teams and released at once. And then how we fit research into our company, because as you'll see, we're doing online advertising, so we are always on the edge of new technologies. So we have to have a dedicated research team that is able to look at some things in the future and see if they are okay for us, so we can adapt them as early as possible. So we have to separate somehow development from research and how it works in agile environment. And I hope in the end you'll have some questions and I'll be happy to answer them. I know that I'm standing behind you and your lunch, so I'll make sure I'm on track. And if I'm telling something which is boring, just raise a hand and tell lunch is waiting, and I know that I have to go to the next point. Okay? Just a disclaimer, this is what worked on my machine, as developers always tell to me. It works on my machine, but not in the environment. It worked for me in Lavasoft, and it works in Adform. Of course, your companies are different, so whatever I tell, don't just go back to your company and implement exactly word by word. Take things that might work in your company, make an experiment, try, and then adapt. It's not some golden truth that I'm presenting my experiences. So let's start with the context. We built a system that does exactly what this guy does. Very simple. No. What does this guy do? He takes someone's advertisements, puts on someone's board, and then when its media campaign is finished, he takes it away. Yes? So he's doing this technical work. So we're building a system that does exactly the same, just online. We're our clients are media agencies. They take someone's banners, put to our system, we display them, we measure them, the performance, and then when campaign is finished, we take them out from internet. But it's neither our banners, neither we create them, neither we plan the campaign, we're a technology provider. So the same as this guy. He doesn't know anything about advertising or drawing. I bet he cannot write as nice as it's written here. So the same as us, we are developing solutions for that. So everyone, of course, sees banners, yes. It's just in Eastern Europe, banners are very ugly and annoying because, again, creativity maybe is not there, but if when we work with Scandinavia or other countries, you can see that there is lots of nice things you can do with banners. Like this guy is pushing away all the site and you can play. This is video cube, turn around, click, and full screen video comes. Or this is, for example, is in-stream conference, in-stream directly to the banner. And if you click, it full screens and you can continue watching the conference. So you can imagine that we have to build all technology to support that. But so it's not an ugly GIF that's, you know, swapping itself every 5 seconds. It's real time. So. Of course, as a system, there has to be a lot of planning tools. I won't get into the detail, but just for you to understand, two teams, so it's about 15 people are working, just making sure that you can start a campaign, put a name, end date, start date, lots of settings, normal thing that any system has to have. Then there is a big backend where we have to serve the banner. So we get 12,000 around the requests per second to serve a banner. So you can imagine that you have to be a scalable solution that has to handle the huge loads. Plus, we want to optimize. So in that millisecond, we have to decide, and here we can even decide which product this user is more likely to buy based on his history that we have tracked a bit. So two things that we have to take in consideration from technology point. Scalability and very fast response times with logics inside. Or even make a price how much this client would like to pay for this impression. You know, real-time auctions in the internet, which you as a client never see, but there is lots of money going in the internet. Of course, every system has to have reporting at the end, what clients want to see how the campaign performs, so they have all the reporting services, different reports, I don't get into details. If there is any more technical people here, this is very high-level architecture, how the system could look like. You have a browser where you see banners, you go to some advertiser's page, or you search something. Of course, we get those transactions, as I mentioned, thousands per second. We have to store it, attributes, so everything goes to reporting tools, business analyst tools, or planning tools, and here are the clients. So that's a very high level. Just to have an understanding, this is, IT guys counted about 240 servers now standing here, so that's quite a bit of different types of servers, different types of systems that we have to deploy and make sure they always work together. So the question, is there anyone in the audience who has a bit more complicated system that one team cannot work on? Or is everyone having only one team, one product, and anyone? A few people, okay, good. Because those who have one team, one product, probably for you is very easy. You just start, read the book, start and implement. And this is what we'll talk about, how to handle in this situation. As I mentioned, we started Scrum in the end of 2009. We had a pilot project, and in 2010, we had at that point 40 technical people, created 6 Scrum teams and started. So last time I was talking about this part, how we moved here, and now I'll be talking how in these 2 years, we created and worked on product management, to create a product management organization during this time, at the same time growing about 30% a year in people sense. So let's start with the teams. And when you read any Agile material, read any conferences, everyone says you have to create feature teams, vertical teams, cross-functional teams that can handle feature from business, from backlog, to implementation, right? You create a cross-functional team, you slice the product vertically, and they implement everything from user interface, backend, reporting, whatever is needed to get it done. Another option is that you can create component teams. And there is a very good book by Craig Larman and Bas Voda that they explain what it is. Feature teams take the first item, implement it, whatever component it touches, releases. Team B takes item 2, implements, releases. Nice, perfect world. Or component teams can take, for example, feature 3, implement it only what's needed in that component, and if some other stuff needed in another component, other component team takes and implements it. two options to go. Of course, Agileists prefer feature teams because teams always take highest value than features, always from top. And there is no delay in the end, you know, there is no waiting when another team will finish. With component teams, teams can start a bit cheating. Like here you see, they are taking item 3, not taking item 1, because probably item 1 has nothing to do with component A. So we're losing this business level priorities, which we want really to keep in Agile. And there can be increased delay at the release. Yes, because you can sometimes need to wait for other teams to finish to really, really release to client. So two options. This is our initial setup of company, 60 people divided to six teams. Every team has a product owner, Scrum Master, and the team. So the question is, did we choose feature or component teams? What do you think? In a system that we had before, feature teams, component. So we have bad Agile, wrong Agile implementation that chose wrong setup. True? Yeah, we chose component teams. We didn't listen what Agile said, and we said we want to go Scrum to do Agile, but we need component teams. Why? Because it was very easy for us to start. We had 40 people, and architecture is much more understandable from technical perspective when you start. When you start with such huge system, you cannot divide it in vertical slices in 2 weeks or 3 weeks. It took us 2 years to get all product management in place. So you organize people around components that they really know about and create those teams. Easy start, you much faster to start. Of course, we did a good thing. We had a testers development department before as a separate one, so we split it and we said now testers goes to each team. So when we finish component, it's already tested as well. It's not development is finished. Of course, there is problems to consider. It's easy to say that, you know, architecture is clear. No, when you started dividing teams, there was 3 weeks discussions or 3 months discussions. So where is the line between those components? Because you just think that architecture is clear, but you have to work it out through time and teams discuss, should we maintain this procedure or should we maintain this procedure? Does this belong to this server type or this server type? Because it pushes data from this server to this server. So they finally made an agreement, some team takes ownership, and you find it, work it out that way. Other problem that we run out is how to run valuable sprint reviews. You know, component team starts working, they finish the sprint, and you come to sprint review. They open you a Visual Studio, press the button, and say, look, all the tests pass. And I'm sitting there as product owner. Yeah, so what? Does it work? All tests pass. Component is implemented. So we had an issue here. I won't talk about very detailed how we solved it, but in the end, what we were trying to do, forcing the team to show the real usage, even if it's not your component. You still need to know how to set it up as a team, and you have to show it in the review how it really works, even if other parts were done by other teams. Or we organize reviews together. Two teams get together, organize a review, so they show at once both functionality work. But sprint review, when you see the code tests passing, not so much valuable for product owner. And the last part is how to plan features. I'll cover it later, so I will jump through it. We'll get back to it. Because this is big problem, how to plan that we really release something to the client. So we have this our high-level architecture, and then everything is easy, yes? You just create teams and put them on different layers, one here, one here, one here. One guys are doing all user stuff in the browser, some are doing integrations with the partners, and two teams doing user interface, one setup, one reporting. Simple. Then we said, actually, we were learning, and there was new kind of system module created that we need to do this optimization to choose more advanced way to choose the banner or the product in the banner. Yeah? So we have some business analysis here, some algorithms that do this clever selection stuff. Here's just pure serving. So again, we split this team to two teams, hire a few more people, and easy, quite easy if you have components to scale. Create a new component and you have a new team and then you go. We are growing as I said 30%, so we see that we are lacking resources on this layer. We split the team to two, hire new people, they come as new ones, after a few months they're up to speed and we can work. So having component teams in a huge system, as I learned, helps you to scale pretty easy if you're a fast growing company, because it's pretty clear for technology departments how to do that. So we have now 8 teams, and of course one person cannot be manager because it's 60 people. You know, when you have to do yearly talks with 60 people, you can count how many hours it takes. So of course, because people grow, we hired new managers, or some people became managers. But the point was, we still were keeping the same Scrum structure. So there is teams. It's just manager is managing few teams, doing an all personal talks, talking about bonuses and all, helping with technical few issues, communication, but not breaking the Scrum structure, you know, just not hiring like .NET developers manager, testers manager, just one who understands how to work with few Scrum teams with people. So again, scalability pretty simple if you keep these boxes all the time. Question, what might go wrong here? Life is never as perfect as you would expect it to be.
Some items get produced not till the end and they are just waiting. They wait to get produced.
You mean some component, part of feature gets implemented in component but never used?
They're implemented but not used by the team because they are not cool.
Yeah. Yeah, it delays, like you create a work in progress.
Cross-layer functions.
Yeah, cross-layer functions, fine. But if looking at the structure, what went wrong here is that we realized that we are applying Conway's law. Anyone knows what it is? It states that organizations which design systems, so software, for example, organizations, are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures of the organizations. He wrote it very complex way. The simpler way to read it is, the structure of your system, software system reflects your organizational structure. So if you have organization organized all these components, this is how you will build your software. You can look at your organizational chart and you will see your software architecture match. I heard about this a bit before but never thought it's real. So, but Adform proved that it is. A few examples. We have one team building internal API. We understood that if we're building internal API, 3 other teams can use it. For example, building currency service. So these guys take some from some bank data, build the service. So if reporting needs a currency to convert from Danish crowns to United States dollars, if in real time we need to translate the bid, they all ask this API. But then the other team that is building the bidder says, what happens if the service is down for an hour? We are doing real time, we cannot wait for an hour. And you know, it's this another team sitting in the other end of the call of the office. We still have access to the same database, so we can just replicate that data to our database, create this, you know, pipe and just use it in our database. We don't use it as service. And of course, we found it and said no. If you fear that this API will break and you need to work it 24/7, then go to these guys and give these requirements to them. This is 24/7 service. It has to be have all measuring mechanisms and has to work. Don't do workarounds. So if we do it our own way, because developers mostly have access to any system, you know, in the database, but it doesn't make sense from company perspective. You're creating this architecture which is, because this team knows this part and they care of it, so they want to use create their own. Other example, for example, which was real, one real case, one team which were doing a serving, building the bidder, so the again service layer that requests lots of requests. Another team, the one that was doing the optimization, builds all the logics, how to decide, and the storage. And then we deploy, and we see we need, I don't know, in that time, 10 servers here, 10 servers here, and 10 servers for storage. And then the question pop up, but actually, the front end and the logics could actually live together very well on one server, because none of them are using full server capacity. So just because you have 2 teams are building this, of course, they both built separate services and implemented their own logic, because you know, to take someone else's code into your code, it's a bit more complicated. So actually, again, we realized this after when we deployed, and then there was after a few months, these were migrated to one server, so we can save and optimize. And of course, there were issues, as there was some bug and took all the RAM, so another service started stopping, but they found a way together. So here is just few proofs that Convey's law is actually is working. And if you go back and look at your organizational structure and take your software architecture, they might match. So we have this, as we saw before, and what did we do? As I said, we said, for example, in this case, we move these two services. Yes, we're creating that this is has to be working together. But the advice here is, and what I would like to suggest to you, if you start with component teams, you have to refactor on teams before you're refactoring the code. What I mean here, when we decided that we really need to do this to work together because this is kind of one feature, we moved few people from here, added here, from here moved, so we kind of changed the structure of these teams. So it's not anymore like here, one team and you know they have to be deployed on one server, but if we change the architecture of the system, we change the teams as well. So we are kind of following, not helping to do better, so keeping it on one wrong people who need to do this job. So then there is no blame that, oh, they did the wrong job, we did the wrong job. It's, I'm not sure if that's a good word to take refactor, but that's what people usually tweet when you put some crazy word next to people. So just an advice. I'm actually borrowing it from the guy. There is a link. So change your teams. If you're moving, making some drastic change, if you have component teams and doing some drastic change in your architecture, adding new component, think about, do we really don't, should we reorganize our team structure as well? Because you might stuck, I want to have permanent teams, and then it will go bad. Does it make sense? Everyone is sitting. I will drink. Damn, no one introduced this good rule. In Lithuania, we had Agile tour. JP Reinsberger said that when speaker drinks, everyone has to applaud. And that was a very, very, very good rule. Then every speaker is not afraid to drink because then you get applauses, so you're happy. Otherwise, there is a complete silence and everyone can hear how I'm making the sound. So it's very embarrassing. Okay, so we had teams and we had component teams. Bad maybe from Agile, perfect Agile perspective, right for us because we managed to work with it. So let's see where product owners, or managers, whatever word you want to call it, came from. So we had these six teams at the beginning. Where do you think we get these guys from? Director, sales, marketing, development.
Teams.
Sorry?
Teams.
From roles. Yeah, but I'm saying when we didn't have anything, we started Scrum. So it was development department from teams, from development. Yeah. Any other ideas? But that's again wrong. Scrum says you have to get some sales guys or marketing guy or some business development manager to become a product owner. You were right. We took them from development. Again, why? Easy start. You change the title, system analyst is product owner, product manager is Scrum Master. Yay, good to go. I'll talk about that in a second. How did this go? Easy synchronization. Everyone knows everyone, so you don't need to teach sales guy now, become a product manager, create this backlog, and you have to talk then with the team. They not so often talk with developers, so it was easy to synchronize. Everyone knows everyone, and analysts new domains as well, so we know where what are components and why this guy is in this team and vice versa. So there were some good things. Of course, the first one hit us very, very fast. We realized that some analysts were really good technical analysts and they really don't want to talk about business and make sure that you have to convince CEO that there is some business manager who really needs that feature and your idea has to wait a bit. It's tough job. So actually after a while we looked at roles, what people really would like to do, and this was not the true anymore. We find the right places. The ones product managers who wanted to be more on business side became product owners. Some analysts stayed analysts, Scrum Masters and then the way when developers who really want to grow as team leads. Problems that if you have product owners from development, they cannot make real return on investment decisions. Of course, they're just more as a secretary to manage the backlog. And we didn't have direct contact with customers. Nevertheless, again, I'm saying, if we have this big organization and you wanted to really try Scrum, for us, it was, even looking at these bad things, it was a good start because we had a fast start and we can at least start managing the backlogs. And when we learn to do them, you will see then we started educating all the rest of the company that, and now product backlog could be organized based more on return on investment decision, not just because it's a list and we have a nice tool to manage it. So as a starters, start wrong, go okay. As I said, we when we had this product owners after a year, we started working more on this backlog, and at the beginning there was everything was basically one system. There was no any product areas, no separation. But when you have product owners, they start realizing that of course we have to split the system to some areas, subcomponents. This is one of the intermediate step. During last year, I think we changed this picture and namings here like 3 times because, you know, it's reorganizing. But at least we have some product area, so it's not, we have, when we have a feature, we know that this feature goes to some area here. It's not somewhere in the system. So it, some structure comes up. As well as we started building product management department. Sounds a bit crazy, but from development, from Scrum implementation, companies started to think that we need product management discipline as such. And this is, again, interesting, but if you read and listen, for example, what Jeff Shutterland was talking after, during 10-year anniversary of Agile Manifesto, he was saying exactly the same, that Scrum or Agile implementation can become as a change agent in the organization, that it grows from development and starts more departments thinking that in an agile way and why we need backlogs and how to organize, streamline the work across organization. So this is was kind of example in our company as well. So we have these product owners in each team. Officially now they are moved to another department. No one can read what's written here, but it's written director product management. So meaning we have a boss, which is organizational structure is different, but we are still in the team. We are keeping that the guy product owner is working with the team, in the team, and keeping that spirit all the way. Although now my boss is this guy and he's telling my salary and all the other stuff. So split the organizational structure and the work structure. These are two different things and they don't need to match. At least that's what we learned. Of course, we started educating because now we need to learn how to do product management. So we get almost all certified. We had specific trainings, normal stuff to grow discipline. Because before everyone was going, you know, in development, of course, on the development conferences, learning to write better code and all that stuff. From the start, we drew this very, I think, a bit crazy structure of how ideas should flow into the product backlogs. So you can see that product owners are quite far from real clients, customers. And again, after a year, we said that product owners should talk to the clients and board and be closer. So this part is not needed. But again, we said it's not needed, and then you run into problems. So how to manage it? So actually, now we are in the process of looking at this chief product owner, product owner's roles, getting a more concrete structure into product management organization. Because we know when you start creating something, you need to write it down nicely to have a nice structure. My point here, we are not yet there. When I read the book about chief product owner or product owners, how the perfect life should be, it's not yet in our company, but we are working towards, and I think we are on a very, very right direction to get there. So, if you're a big system and you want to start Agile or Scrum, my advice is start with even product managers, product owners from development. It will be much easier than going and educating your some business manager or someone to BPO and teach why estimating in stories is worthless. You just need to count items, what Vasco was saying at the beginning. I mean, they will say, what are you talking about? All the year I was doing in hours, and what story points I even have no clue what I'm about. So you can start it, of course, then you pushing your Agile implementation further and looking. Either I'm creating a new department, as in our case, or if there are really good people, so we try educating them. In our case, it was the same. One of product managers later become, he was a key account manager, and he started taking a role as a product owner. So taking from other parts of organization, building this product management. Just the point for me is don't think that if Agile book says that this has to be the person with business knowledge, return on investment decisions, and have possibility to tell no even to CEO that you have to start there. No, you can start where you can start. So the next topic is about features. How to plan a feature where you need when you need few component teams to implement it. Thank you. I guess this is the most interesting part now then. Let's take the same example, video cube. Yes, very interesting to play. You turn it around, it follows your mouse, and then you click it full screen. Perfect, perfect, nice banner, and then the client calls and says, I need a feature. For example, I want to count how many times users actually turned it. So I can see a report to see how engaging the banner was. You know, if no one turned it, then no point having this complex thing. Just a normal case sample. So what do we need to do? Some checkbox or option has to come in the UI, so we plan this UI team has to work on it. The banner itself has to be able to handle this event, so some new parameter added in this component. Then of course this ad serving layer has to accept new parameter. It has to be stored and attributed so all reporting knows that it was clicked. And then of course in the reports we need either add new report or have a column added. So this is a real example, a very simple, small feature. We need five teams to work on it. How to plan and execute it? Again, at the beginning, we were very brave, and of course, we know how to do it. Let's start the way that we really know, and how all technical people say. Let's, you know, see who is doing first, second, third. It's three teams, just for simplicity reasons. So when these guys do their job, we take the result, we implement what's our job, we give it to them, they implement their job, and we release. How do you think that this go?
As expected.
We thought it was slowly it would be a good thing. If we really would make like this, probably we would be happy and even not think any further. The problem was that reality was like this. Team finishes his job, then of course they at the beginning have to explain these guys what to do. Then these guys finish their part, then we have to integrate and test if it really works at the end. Then we move to the first sprint, these guys start, so this has to explain how to do, and then we again have to integrate and test all together. So a classic example how waterfallish style of forking really does not work. Oh, actually it works quite well for these guys, but very wrong for these guys. The ones that start are always the worst ones. Because they didn't implement something which is really needed here, because we figure out that we really need it here, just here. I don't know. So the thing started that the teams, we won't start. Let them start first, and then we'll be the second or third ones, you know. Because they realize the ones that are first always gets the blame, the most blame or most rework. So then we thought what actually works, and maybe we should start thinking that we are agile and think about some of these ideas that we work in a team. So first we need a clear feature PO. Who is really needed? Who is really driving this feature? And there's one product owner for it. So in this case, for example, the banner turning event, probably it would be the one this is managing reporting system, because at the end client cares about the report. Client doesn't care that you have to set it up, pass it through the system. He cares if you have it in report, and if it does it, does it report the right stuff. So the guy would be the main PO, and then we would try to drive this process. We meet together POs and SMs and see how much work is in each team. Maybe if we forgot which one team, maybe we didn't. So we make some plan, and then we plan the next work so we would finish all together. Doesn't matter that this team is need input from this team, they can agree on interfaces at the beginning in this meeting, and then just start implementing without it, then we implement, test, and we plan the release together. Even if it goes through a few sprints, then this team wouldn't even start here, it would start here, because, for example, if this team needs to work through two sprints. Again, it looks very nice in the graphs, very hard to implement in real life, because developers here saying, but we need that database structure to start working on this. And anyone can give an advice to them?
Just make a structure.
Make a structure, one advice. What else? Mocking the system, if we agreed how it is, so we can fake that there is an interface and all of them implemented, and there are ways to get around it. So, of course, we needed to come to discuss with them and to convince that you don't need to have database structure to start working on your back, and you can just assume that it will be like this and then work, and if it changes a bit here, we will fix it in integration phase. Sorry? It will change anyway. That's the point. They didn't believe that, but of course, after doing a few times, they realized that it changes. So it's no point arguing here about very much details. Just start working, and we will fix it here together. And that's a very good thing, because teams start working, talking together, helping each other, and really make sure that it gets done. Because, you know, in review, as I said, if you have your, or in this case, if you have here all your tests passing, it doesn't mean that feature will be actually implemented. It's just green. We are doing test-driven development. Perfect. We are a great agile team. Great team, no business value. So we learned this, and I started calling it cross-functional teams of teams, because if you look, if I would write here team member one, team member two, team member two, that's what we do in a team. That's what we call great cross-functional teams. Developer, test, analyst has to work together so they finish stuff together. So just exactly the same principle applies across the teams. If you have many teams doing one feature, start thinking that these are your people in a team, and they have to do exactly the same. They have to have even sometimes Scrum Master, product owner. So this guy is product owner. Someone is leading the maybe technical discussions. So make sure that it happens, and we get it done. Yeah. So even if you have component teams, it works. Your components are your Java developer, .NET developer, and tester, or whatever role, analyst role you have in your team. Any questions for this one? Perfect. Nice. So, the last part, research. Anyone has separate research department or someone who is doing research at your company, not exact tomorrow's sprint development? One company, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Nice. Okay, there is a few people. So we started Scrum. Again, the same picture, getting boring, but that's where we started. So who does research here? What do you think? Sorry? Teams, all teams.
A lot of teams.
Spike is doing, yeah. No, we did it different. We said team six, we had few architects, and then we put them to one team and said, you guys will do some features as well as you'll do research, because we are creating, because we want to do Scrum. We have to have all Scrum teams. So no someone doing something. So that's where we started. How did it go? Anyone knows what happens when team has to do research and develop features? Which one? Which one doesn't happen in real in most companies, at least? Yes, there is always what to do. Yeah. Next week we'll look into this. Next week we'll look into this. Today there is a problem we need to fix. So more or less that's what's happening. Yes, they were doing some research and research and trying to convince product owner that we need to have some time, but you know, life is life. Team, if they are responsible for features, they implement features, and that's how it goes. So we, after a few months, we realized this is not the best structure, and then we looked again at theory, what could help us. So I hope someone has seen this graph I'm using very, very often to convince non-agile companies where actually IT products are. You see, this is requirements, so either requirements can be very close or very far from agreement. Either we really know what to do, have technical clear specification, or we have just idea and we're going somewhere, and we can be in between. Here is technology. Either we know exactly the technology that we are going to use, or we are not clear and we are going to investigate and find a way through it. So where are IT projects in this graph? What do you think? In anarchy? I think if your IT projects are in anarchy, you're a bit too far away from. Yeah, either complicated or probably complex. Yes, some requirements are known. At least we have some product backlog, vision where we are going, and technology, of course, we know some, probably more, but some we will find out on the way. You can discuss with Jürgen later which one it is. I try to understand the difference, but it's not for my head. There's too complex stuff, or complicated. Not sure which one. Anyway, so software projects are somewhere like here. And this is why empirical model works, because if you read the theory, empirical model works for complex stuff. The linear process, describe process perfectly works here. So if you're building a new television or a new car model, you would use this process. When you have a car model, you will make 1,000 cars using the waterfall style, linear style model. In software, we should do the same. When we build product, we build in this process, empirical process. When we print CDs, we don't need an empirical process. We just print 1,000 CDs per second. So we're using, you know, conveyor. The problem that we're trying to create product using conveyor process sometimes, and these don't match. So. But that side effect. So we have software projects here. So where is the research? Here? No? Yes. With research, you usually don't know requirements. You have, there is no SQL databases. Can they be used for our problem or not? Because SQL databases seems not to solve our problem anymore. They don't scale too so fast and all that stuff. So technology, yeah? Requirements the same. We don't know even maybe where we're going. If you start startup, usually they start here. You have three people. You don't need Scrum planning, stand-up, and sprint retrospectives and review for three people doing startup. They just sit and do stuff. Of course, when they grow, when they have 10 people, then you have to have some more concrete process to follow. So, but don't go too far. So this is the model. So yes, we thought that research is something that is anarchy. We don't need to control it. So what we need to do, we just moved all the guys to one separate department and said, sit there and we will give you priorities and try to work according to those priorities. We give you priority to find out this. We give probably you some time frame, 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, you are coming with some results. Result might be very often, sorry, it doesn't fit to us. So. Wrong, but we spend the time and we investigate. And actually then they started working with teams as consultants, helping the teams to sort out the problem. What does it mean? And why it's good? These guys then, they had some dedicated time, yes? They're not doing features, they are dedicated. They can have find time to review legacy applications. We still have lots of legacy code. I don't know, maybe you don't, but we do, and we're trying to get this out piece by piece, but there is still, and they have time to review it, to see what's our technical debt, where is the most important to improve, give these discussions. But the most important, they can ask consultants like questions. When they come to the team, they say, why are you doing this? Why are you adding this? So team starts really thinking, you know, because when team is responsible for component, they just go and they think this is the best way. So when the guys from a side can question if this is the best case, sometimes they prove that it's not the best case and then they find a way to work to find a new technology or something. So, of course, there is some issues with this as well. For example, at the beginning, we put them to new department and they said, yes, now we can do whatever we want. After months we meet and they were doing some crazy technology research stuff. And we say, how that goes with our company level priorities. Yeah, you know, once they talked that we might need it and it's really cool. I know that it's really cool for you, but we have to align it with, you know, company level priorities. If we see that there is a big items are coming, please work on these items, not at whatever you think is the most cool. Or convince us that what you found here is really business critical, so we all agree and then you start working on it, not hiding and doing some stuff. Then we started, we had another issue because the guys were sitting, you know, in different rooms, so they start working. Do we have some structure here? Yeah, for example. They are working on something which is actually owned by this team. They do stuff, they say, oh, we find a perfect solution. We almost implemented, made proof of concept, now guys just implemented. These guys take and, come on. We need to rewrite anything from scratch. Where did you come up? You know, just we did the job, the cool job, and now you do the implementation. So that didn't work as well. So this is why this kind of virtual teams term came up, that if there is a problem to solve in this component, these guys goes, sits next to the guys and work together on it, finding solution, being as real consultants for the team, they finish the job and then move out. Not we do the research and then give it for you to implement. And then the last part, just not forget to communicate the results, because when you're doing technological improvements, you sometimes forget, yeah, we changed the reporting service to new something. And so, but if you say our reports now generate 3 times faster, or instead of getting this report in 20 seconds, now you get it in 2 seconds on the user interface. That's the stuff that really product managers are happy about, and that's how we can sell your research. So just the bottom line, of course, have research if you're a really advanced company and treat it differently. It cannot be in Scrum, in iterations, because it doesn't work like that. You have to have it aside, and our way was working as consultants for these Scrum teams, helping them with everyday job. So in summary, what I hope you could take from this talk is that You can start with component teams, and it's okay. It's if you are big, of course. If you are doing web development with 7 people, don't start with backend, business layer, and UI. But if you are more than 50, probably it's a good idea for you to think about that. But of course, if you're changing again your architecture, adding something new, try to reorganize your teams. Don't forget that. Start with product management from development. It's easy in big organization. You start your Scrum, you learn the process, and then educate the rest, either create the rest as we did, or educate and try to get relevant people from other departments to be product owners. If you have multi-teams feature, treat them as cross-functional teams of teams. Make sure that you end together and plan it at the beginning, so you start whatever is needed, but you all end together. The final integration is done together. And last part, if you have research, I hope you do, treat it differently as development. Separate process, helping development, not being in the part of 2-week cycles or whatever sprints you have. That was it, and I hope you enjoyed it and you will have some questions. Should I drink now?
Hi. Have you considered to have also the component and the feature team? I mean, if you have some component team that work on a component that other feature team can use, do you think that is possible to have this organization?
The question is if we consider to having like team that would be like this.
Yeah, but you have to consider not a component like product layer, but a component like a service, for example, that other feature team can use.
Yeah, we considered, actually we were discussing if this is really a good way to go, because as I mentioned, we wanted to do good Scrum, and in the company before, where in Lavasoft it was a smaller team, so we really had feature teams. But like in our example, the add that one feature, you need a Flash developer who adds it here. You need a .NET developer who is skilled in lots of support of lots of load systems, so that type of skills. Here is all app databases and reporting services on all the reporting crap, which I'm not, I'm sorry, good stuff which I don't have competence about, and here is lots of just UI development, okay? So very, very different skills of people, and we realized that if we add Flash developer to this kind of team, and in the next sprint they are just doing some backend optimization, I mean, what the Flash developer will do that? So we considered, and in our case we said it's impossible. And after 2 years, I think I'm concluding that that was the right decision, because we are just two huge system, 60 people, like 8 people here, 8 here, you know, each team is about 6-7 people, so it's not that easy to share. We found a way through.
Okay, hi. You said that in case of cross-functional, cross-component feature, you have to create a cross-component team. But doesn't it end that most of the features are cross-component and so how do you manage that?
Sure, it actually is what you are saying. So what the problem to run this process every time? Most of our stuff is cross-functional, as you say. So when we have the backlog, product owners, this organization, what we're trying to solve now, discusses, okay, I have this feature, and I'm assuming, I think I'll need this and this component to make sure it works. So I'm going in the planning phase before, of course, sprint starts. I'm going talking with these two product owners. We are discussing how it's prioritized according to other priorities. Because you can go to this, for example, product owner of team 2, and he says, we have 3 business critical items and 2 sprints I think are fully packed. Unless you convince chief product owner or director that whatever you need is more important, we can come back later. So then I, as the one who wants that feature, I know that I can plan this one only here. We have this company level roadmap that we meet and always review, because you are just dependent on other teams, and the only way you can plan that, I will deliver the feature when all available teams will be available. And if I need it, either I convince the product owner of this team that this is more important than what he is doing, his features. If he says no, then again, on company level, we prioritize. Yes. So no point doing this sprint here if this team cannot do it, it doesn't have time and we'll be able to implement it here anyway. So we are organizing this in this product owner organization. But that's everyday job. That's what basically all the time we're doing. For every sprint, for almost every bigger feature. Yeah, it's just.
Could you speak more about the mechanics, how you evaluate the feature, the scope of the feature? Because actually, once you have three teams, it's like three groomings, separate groomings, then you put them to one bigger one, and like how do you prioritize? Or
What's the reason for getting the scope? To see if it's big enough, it's not too big to put the...
If you think about the value created, like return on investment, you have to know the investment you make. Yeah. So it's like you have to add all this from all the teams and then prioritize it and so on.
Yeah, I will probably contradict it, but Vasco's talk in the morning, our estimation goes very fast. Maybe we learned it through 2 years, but for us to get poker cards and make it's 5 minutes play usually, so it doesn't take 5 hours. So when we are in this meeting, sometimes even without the Scrum teams, with Scrum Masters, we can say, what feeling do you have? Is it 8 or 13 or 5? And every team, this cross-functional team gives the number, and at that point you have the kind of understanding what the size will be. If we really say, okay, this is good enough, we put into the sprint, then these guys, during next grooming session, talk with the team and then groom it exactly and give the right more concrete number. And then in the sprint planning, of course, they plan it in with hours. So in this level process, when the estimation techniques your teams learn to do very fast, in few minutes, because it's just comparing, you know, to stuff that we were doing before, for us it definitely doesn't take any time. It's not a bottleneck, at least as far as I see it, we can have a very good feeling of the size in short sessions to get to talking.
Any other questions or no? Or yeah, the final one.
Do all of the teams always have work to do? Doesn't it create a we really don't have anything to do until, but this team is overloaded?
No, there is always what to do. We didn't run into that problem, never. And there is always more to do than teams can. The question is about just prioritization. So maybe looking from all company perspective, sometimes one team is doing less important work than they can in theory. I mean, you know, if you have one product backlog for the company, in theoretical best case, how it should be in a company, and then just 8 teams taking from top feature teams, that's the most effective way. But in our case, every team has more or less its own priorities, and no, we don't have that problem. As I said, if maybe we are not that efficient in this part, but I think we are efficient because we have a company level prioritization. We're looking which team should do which job and prioritizing according to that. So as long as product managers meet together, I think we are getting the right priorities. And I bet each of the team without any new features could work on their stuff and refactor and make code nice for 2 years at least. If the business says we don't need any new features, they could be working for 2 years and they would definitely find what to do because, you know, it's development. Developers always know how to make something more cool. Code look more nice or refactored or whatever terms they use.